So, you sign on, you get a card, and you can go to various businesses and get some sort of incentive or discount. There are certain special packages. I believe Zion has something called the Affinity Package. So when you call them up, ask for that. The information is contained in the booklet and you have application form. Now, there is a charge involved. For members of the Queen's College PTA and the Queen's College Association, you pay $20. If you are not a financial member of either of those two organizations, you pay $50 for the card. And that runs for the duration of the year. So we have agreements with those advertisers, and we have some other people who will also be coming on board. Future plans include a website and other forms of advertising as we get more and more people coming on board. I'm happy to say the response was quite warm, actually. And I think that we'll be seeing a lot more people signing on board. But please, I will hand out some forms. My contact information is on there.
I want to report on one other matter, the performance in the theater. If you read our strategic plan, we say that one of our performance indicators is to look at how all students perform after they leave school. So all the statistics that Ms. Ames has reported, so I'd like to report on the six cohorts that left last year. Out of 122 students, of 45 males and 77 females. 77 of those students, total of 77, are now in Mona, in the Gustin of Gateville. One is at the Samuel Jackson University Polytechnic, two at the Barbados Community College, and the others are spread around universities around the world: Ryerson, Missouri State, Waterloo, London, McGill, Bristol, Florida Tech, Wells, Halifax, Tony Book in New York, Howard, and Marriott Watt. In the area of study, 16 are doing medicine, 7 engineering, 9 law, 16 are doing a combination of account, finance, and banking, 27 are doing management, law, sociology, international, and the others are doing a combination of international relations, political science, psychology, computer science, pure and applied sciences, and graphic arts. That is as much as we can hear so far. So we have 3 of them who went to work, 2 are non-national. Now our strategic plan says that we aim for 98% of any group to go on to higher institutional learning, and from what I tell you, we'll reach the target of 97.5%.
American Edition was approached a few years ago by UNICEF. They had an interest in looking at this whole question of corporal punishment, which they saw as one of the major issues affecting children in schools and in homes across Barbados. And we did some initial research. However, we deferred until a later date to do a major study. As fate would have it, the government of Barbados had commissioned a national commission, National Commission that looked at various educational issues. UNICEF thought at that point it would make a lot of sense to drag us back in cadres and have us do a national survey that spoke to several of these educational issues, and included on that would have been this whole issue of corporal punishment. So we've done fairly detailed data, and we have a sense of how people feel about it. Interestingly enough, we also have a sense of how children felt about it based on our 2004 work. We did children and we also did adults. However, the recent study, basically we looked at a national cohort of people. And that's going to give you a very basic perspective on this one issue. As I said, the others could speak to the other one. What we basically found in 2004, should I start by telling you very briefly what the legal situation is. The legal situation is well known to you all. According to the laws of Barbados, parents are able to use what they call reasonable chastisement on their children in the home, and also in the school, the principal or his designate, in this case, has the right to do so. You all are also aware of the convention that Queen's College, St. Michael's, and all of the private secondary schools have on their own agreement decided that they would not be talking students from their school. So you all are in a unique case, which is another issue, but that's not anything for here. But this is by convention, by law, of course, parents have the right to do it, and also teachers have the right to do it. UNICEF has a stated position that they're not comfortable with it. The government of Barbados has always had a very ambiguous position on it. Legally, the laws say clearly that this is what can happen. The challenge, however, that I have is that we only have one reference to the law specifically, as opposed to the historic common law position. We only have one reference, and that's a recent reference that was made in the Educational Act that just prescribed this is something that can be done, but there are no specifics on how, with what, the condition. It's a very bland statement, and I have to tell you that as a political analyst, I appreciate the reasons why that has not changed, because anytime government goes back to it and touches it, it essentially is legislating corporal punishment, which governments are ill-advised to do in this current social context globally, where it is seen as something that's not good. So government of Barbados has taken a hands-off approach. Until they can act to abolish, I'd be very surprised if they actually go back and legislate to create conditions. Because if you create a condition, then essentially, from a political perspective, the optics tend to raise some questions. In 2004...
behaviors are not learned overnight. And when children begin to exhibit certain behaviors, you also have to understand that they will not change overnight. And you're not going to be able to lick them out or beat them out or any of those things, which I'm sure we will get down to very soon. These are things that would have evolved, and it's going to take time to change them, provided the correct course of action is taken. Now, it's clear that the responsibility that rests on the shoulders of parents is very great. And generally speaking, there's no formal training and preparation for this role and function, and I'm sure the expert on parenting, head of part office here, and she will have a lot more to say about this. But unfortunately, for this very, very critical function, and in some cases lifelong role, the individual draws on their own observations and experiences of what obtained in their households when they were growing up. So let us consider then the fundamental and comprehensive damage that is done when the parenting process goes awry.
And as long as you're a parent, that job is going to take you past retirement, right into eternity. And so it is awesome. Many parents go into parenting without knowing a thing about parenting except what they saw the mommy and the grandmommy and granddaddy do. And parenting in this era is far different, because children are different. Children are more assertive, because parents are more assertive. What my parents did, my parents are both deceased, but the strategies that they used, I became educated, as the statistics show, the more educated you become, the more you should be able to cope with your children. But we are doing it in the opposite way. The more educated we are, the higher up in the society we go, the more we take on the jobs, the more responsibilities outside of the home. And at Paradox, what we are seeing is children who say, like Roger said earlier, I don't get to see my parents often. You may ask me, what do children need from their parents? Children need, especially at the adolescent stage when they're confused, there's so much happening in their bodies, the hormones that are working over time. They grow spurts. They're uncertain about so many things. They're trying to come into their own, themselves, find themselves, and they need guidance. They need the guidance from their parents, otherwise someone else will guide them. They also need trust. I trust my mother, I trust my parents, and my parents trust me. And trust can only be built up over time and with close interaction. Your adolescent children need to be able to make wise decisions that you approve of. And you can only approve of them if you know the decisions that they're making. So you must be there, you must find time to interact with them so that they know what you approve of, you share your values, and then they're able to make decisions based on what they have been taught in their home.
the major core of our work is from a perspective that, and the one that I use my children, I tell my three daughters, 8, 11, and 12, they hear it every day, I, daddy, cannot control you. You have free will. You have free choice. I can never take that away. But however, mom and I have the authority to then determine the consequences based on the choices that you make. And for us, the whole idea is the more we can help them to understand that they have choices every single circumstance, and then understand how they can make wise choices, understand the benefits of wise choices, but at the same time understand the consequences of unwise choices, with all the things that they are facing today that we can even imagine facing in our time, the only way that we feel they can be able to deal with all the pressures and things coming at them is if they are strong enough at this age to be able to make choices. Now, whether that will work or not, time will tell in a couple of years' time. But that is the focus. But it's not only focused with children, it's the focus with adults. And I even dare suggest that most of us adults don't really know ourselves. We don't take time to look at ourselves. In fact, a lot of us adults don't even understand the power of free choice that we have. And so often we're doing things thinking that we have no other choice, because some of the choices that make can result in some tough or uncomfortable consequences, and we don't want the uncomfortable consequences, so we make other choices and say we don't have a choice. And the whole idea is that the more we understand the power of personal choice, the more our minds open to how we can respond to whatever life or anyone throws at us. But in addition to it, the more we understand personal choice, and understand that who I am today is a function of all the choices that I have made, even when I didn't know I had choice. So my parents didn't make me who I am. My father, my mother, my doctor, my lawyer, my teacher, my pastor, the community, the environment didn't make me. But who I am is all the choices that I made, given all of those things that those persons tried to influence me toward. But I still had to make the choice. But the idea here, guys, is that once we understand the power of choice, we can now open our minds to, if I have a choice, and my choice may be who I am, the only thing that can make me the best that I can be is also my choice.
I had a young man who pretty much came from a very good home, and his parents are actually prominent people in this nation. They said to me the first assessment that this son had everything he wanted. The love, the money, nice home. Actually, begged him if he could come and visit and sleep a couple of times. He has a car available to him at 16 years old. So he has what he needs. The problem is that in his family interventions we sat around, this young man, who I was so proud of, stand in front of his parents and said to his parents, "You give me everything, but the only thing you did not give me was your attention." He said that from his mouth. And the mother and father reiterated, "How do you mean attention? Well, we made sure you had this, we made sure that." He said, what about the quality time? You know, I prefer to spend time on the ground with my friends, learning about different types of subcultures, because they take the attention, they give me the attention I need. They knock me and tell me how safe I is. I use my dog and my nigger. And he feels respected. And somehow he didn't get from the parents. So we have to come back to the ground zero and decide in ourselves whether or not work, business, clubs, all these kind of activities are important, or whether the important factor now is to spend some time knowing your child before later on they create problems for you. A child who's not parented properly.